morning. Welcome to Shepherd of the Hills. We begin our worship today with hymn 424. Kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness, and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble.
I will rescue his hand.
the Father and to the Son
and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning,
is now and will be forever. Amen.
When he calls to me, I will answer him. With long life I will satisfy him
and show him my
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, you led your ancient people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide the people of your church that following our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world toward the glory of the world to come. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for the scripture reading.
The Old Testament reading comes to us this first Sunday in Lent from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 26, beginning with the first verse. When you came into the land that the Lord your God has given you for an inheritance and take possession of it and live in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from your land that the Lord your God has given you, and you shall put it in a basket. And you shall go to the place that the Lord your God will choose to make his name to dwell there. And you shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, I declare today that the Lord your God, that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall make response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my father, and he went down into Egypt and sojourned there, few in number, and there he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and humiliated us and laid on us hard labor. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great deeds of terror, with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And behold, now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground, which you, O Lord, have given me. And you shall set it down before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. And you shall rejoice in all the good that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house, you and the Levite and the sojourner who is among you. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle lesson for this day comes from the book of Romans, chapter 10, beginning with the 8th verse. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is, the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will be all yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we continue with the choir.
Thank you.
I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in
In the name of Jesus, amen. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted of the devil. And he ate nothing during those days, and when they were ended, he was hungry. That baptism of Jesus, when the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove, and the Father, with a voice from heaven, proclaimed, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased," that was not just an artistic flourish. That was not just a sentimental moment where he was touched by the Holy Spirit and everything was sunshine and smiley faces and rainbows. That was not just some nice little extra. But he was anointed by the Holy Spirit at his baptism in the Jordan River, and now that Holy Spirit leads him, not on a rosy path, not through ease, not through sunshine and relaxation and peace and comfort. No. But the Holy Spirit drives Jesus out into the wilderness. Not into paradise, but quite the opposite. Into the wilderness. And there in the wilderness, he fasts. He afflicts himself. He does without. He commends himself into God's merciful keeping. Fasting makes you weak. Fasting makes you vulnerable. Fasting like this for 40 days is not fun. But that's what the Spirit drove Jesus to do. And out there in the wilderness, Jesus goes to battle against the devil. The devil finds him and he says, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." The very first word, "if," already now the devil is injecting doubt. That's part of this temptation. Merely by asking if, the devil is injecting doubt. It's as if the devil is saying, "If you are really the Son of God, then prove it to me, prove it to yourself. If you are the Son of God and you have miraculous strength, then turn this stone into bread and end this suffering right now." So the nature of this temptation, the devil wants him to doubt that he is truly the Son of God. But again, the Lord himself already said, "You are my beloved Son." So the nature of the temptation is to doubt the sure and certain promise that God has already proclaimed from heaven. It's as though the devil's telling Jesus, "Look around you, look at your circumstances. You're out here in this desert. You are in a sorry and painful state. You want to tell me you're the Son of God? Forget about it." But what is more sure and certain than any circumstance? What is more sure and certain even than evidence and scientific proof? What is more sure and certain than your own eyes and your own ability to observe than the very Word of God itself? And the Word of God from heaven said, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." Therefore, it was so. Notice, too, that Jesus doesn't argue with the devil like Eve did. Eve got into a discourse, a conversation with the devil. The devil said, "Did God really say you can't touch or eat any tree from the garden?" And then already he grabbed her. Already at that point, the devil had her, because then she started to go back and forth and have a discussion with the devil. All that Jesus does is quote God's word to the devil. He refutes the devil by means of God's word, not by means of his reason, not by means of trying to outsmart him, not even by means of fighting with him, so to speak, but merely by resorting to the word of God. Another aspect of this first temptation is that Jesus end the temptation. The temptation is that Jesus end the temptation. The temptation is that Jesus cut his suffering short, that he turn the stone into bread, feed himself, no longer suffer for our sins. The temptation is that Jesus have salvation apart from the cross, and a salvation for himself, not a salvation for us. Turning a stone into bread and eating it, Jesus would have saved himself from a temporary hunger, but then he would not have gone on to the cross to save us from our sins. And so Jesus, we see here, Jesus hungers for you more than he hungers for bread. He's willing to fast for 40 days and 40 nights for you because he desires you more than he desires bread. He is willing to suffer and sweat it out and go toe-to-toe with the devil if that's what it takes in order to win you and me back from our sins and the curse of the devil and our inevitable death. Jesus hungers for you more than he hungers for earthly bread. Now the second temptation, verses 5 through 8, the devil shows him in a moment of time all the kingdoms of the world in their glory. And the devil says, these have been given to me and I will give them to you if you will but worship me. It will all be yours. And so the temptation here is a deliverance or a glory, again, apart from going to the cross. The devil wants to give him all of these kingdoms of the world apart from the cross. Now, it had already been promised to Jesus that he would receive all the kingdoms of the world. Psalm chapter 2, kiss the Son lest he be angry. The Lord is speaking to his Messiah, and he is promising, to you I have given all the nations of the earth, and you will break them with a rod of iron. And so here the devil is shifting a little bit. The devil is now promising Jesus, yet again, something different from God's promise. The first temptation, if you are the Son of God, prove it to me. This one now, he's promising him something that God has already given him. God has already promised that Jesus will inherit the nations of the earth, but after the cross, after Easter. Suffering must come before glory. And so there's a temptation here that Jesus, that all these kingdoms would be delivered into Jesus' possession apart from his death on the cross. A cheaper glory, a much cheaper glory, a glory without suffering, a glory that is merely given to him, not one that he has agonized upon the cross to earn for us. But after he truly did die on the cross for your sins and mine, he did something even more remarkable than merely the nations of the earth flowing to him and falling down before him and being in the palm of his hand in his possession. He did something far more remarkable. He laid down his life and he died and he went into a tomb and he did something that had never been done before. He shattered the grave and its power forever and ever and shattered the power of the devil. And so Jesus achieved a far more remarkable glory, an even more glorious glory, if you will, than just the cheap glory of all the nations of the earth being magically given over to him in a moment of time because he bowed down to worship the devil. Jesus desires to go to the cross. He desires our salvation more than anything else. In verses 9 through 12, it seems as though the devil has now started to wise up a little bit. Jesus has refuted him twice by means of Scripture. And so now the devil goes to Scripture, only he twists it toward his ends. He makes it say what it does not truly say. Verses 9 through 12, Jesus says, if you are the Son of God, again that satanic if you are the Son of God, prove it. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from the pinnacle of the temple, for God promised that he will protect you. He said that he will command his angels to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone. And Jesus replies to this temptation, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. And so the nature of this third temptation is a deliverance apart from the cross, that Jesus would be saved, that he would display his glory, but apart from the cross. Again, as I said, his glory was revealed precisely in going to the cross and sacrificing himself and then shattering the grave on Easter Sunday. Here is, again, a cheaper form of glory. Rather than going to the cross and dying for sinners and shattering the grave by rising again, the temptation is that he jump from the pinnacle of the temple and not die and have God rescue him from that death. So yet again, a temptation to not go to the cross, a temptation to not struggle and wrestle and fight for your salvation. A temptation for a cheap and showy form of grace. And likewise, Jesus says that this would be testing God, putting God to the proof, doing something as foolish as jumping off of a building and telling God to rescue you. That is putting yourself above God. That is dictating to God how he ought to navigate in the world. That is dictating to God how he ought to relate to you and save you, rather than humbly bowing before God and seeing him as a merciful and kind and giving Father, but nonetheless, one who you don't have claims over, This is a temptation to set yourself over God, to dictate to God, to tell him how he ought to act, how he ought to relate to you, how he ought to save you. And so Jesus once again refutes it simply by quoting Scripture, "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. We hear that in the New Testament. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. He will eventually get tired of having God's promises thrown in his face. He will eventually grow tired of having you resist his will. And we see that here in Jesus' example. Jesus has resisted the devil three times by means of Scripture, and the devil has fled from him. So three points of application then, in general, about temptation. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Holy Spirit promises us that no temptation has seized us or come upon us except that which is common to man, that is, common to humankind, common to humanity. In other words, when each and every one of us is tempted, we are not tempted with some kind of a superhuman temptation. We are not tempted with some temptation which it is impossible for us to overcome. The Lord will not permit us to fall into such a temptation. But when the temptation comes our way, the Lord provides a way of escape, we are told yet again in 1 Corinthians 10. A way of escape is provided so that we can flee from it. Now some people will ask, okay then, I fall into temptation all the time. What does this verse mean? Well, it means that you are falling under a temptation that you can withstand. And so it is an even more accusing verse for those times when we fall under temptation. When we fall in the midst of temptation, we are falling under temptations that the Lord has permitted us to undergo and temptations that we have the power to withstand, not in and of our own strength, but in and of our baptism and the Holy Spirit being present within us and the Word of God that we have heard with our ears, that we can confess with our tongue and combat the devil with. We can withstand that temptation. There is a way of escape with the help of God and under his grace. Another point about temptation is not to reason during temptation, not to argue with the devil or with your flesh. Then you're setting yourself up for a losing battle. When we face a temptation, what we should do is meet it with the Word of God. We should meet it with prayer. We shouldn't sit there and dialogue with the devil or dialogue with ourselves. We're setting ourselves up, like Eve, for a losing battle. As soon as you enter into a face-to-face confrontation with the devil, you're giving him an opportunity to get his head in. And when a snake can get its head in, it can get the rest of the body in. Or if you want to talk about a constrictor, you're letting him chomp on you with his head, and then he's going to coil around you and then crush you. Don't reason with yourself, with your flesh, or with the devil. Rather, run to Scripture, run to prayer, and run away from the devil. We might be tempted to think that circumstance will justify our disobedience. Surely God will understand. He's a merciful God. Doesn't he want me to be happy? We might try to talk ourselves into sinful behaviors such as cohabitation or sexual intercourse before marriage, moving in with someone before getting married. We'll tell ourselves, well, this makes sense. It's the right thing. It's a wise financial decision. Or we might try and talk ourselves into some kind of dishonest business or academic practice, cheating to get ahead. Surely God will understand. Surely it's no big deal. I need to look out for myself. No. Simply run to Scripture, see what it plainly says, and quote it to yourself, quote it to the devil. And that's related to the second point of application. Know Scripture and use Scripture. Come to church every Sunday. Come to Bible study. Hear it, read it, mark it, learn it, inwardly digest it. Read it throughout the week as well. Memorize it. Work it into your prayer life. Have it ready so that you can use it in times of temptation. Have it ready so that you can use it in times when you are hurting or someone else is. Have it ready for times of joy, so that you can give thanks to God for all things rather than merely lounging and enjoying all the great benefits he's given you. Have Scripture ready and use it as a form to pray to God. And number three, we can't escape hardship just because we have the Holy Spirit in our lives. Some Christians think quite the opposite. You'll hear that quite a bit with the TV preachers, the prosperity gospel, that you will avoid hardship and that you will be rich and that you will be happy because Jesus and the Holy Spirit are in your life. But what happened to Jesus here? Full of the Holy Spirit, he is driven not to a bed of roses, not to paradise, but he is driven into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil in order to do battle. It's the same thing with us. The Holy Spirit's influence in our lives quite often will make us uncomfortable. Quite often will have us go head-to-head with the devil or with our own temptations. The Holy Spirit has come upon us at the font in baptism, not just so that we can lounge and have a nice, sentimental, touching moment with the Holy Spirit in our lives, but rather we are anointed just like Jesus was anointed. Back in the Old Testament, prophets, priests, and kings, or sometimes warriors, were anointed. They were anointed for specific missions, anointed to carry out work. And Jesus' name, or I should say Christ, that title Christ or Messiah, means the anointed. He was anointed there in the Jordan River in order to earn and struggle for our salvation. It's very similar with us. We are baptized, the Holy Spirit enters into our hearts and lives, so that we might do battle against the devil, and so that God would take us through the painful journey through this life into the life to come. Just because Jesus is in our lives doesn't mean that things will be easy, and quite often it means exactly the opposite, but it's worth it. We were baptized for something better than merely hedonism, merely just feeding our flesh, feeding our bellies, and enjoying this world, this side of heaven. We were baptized for far more. Baptized in order to do battle with our own sinful desires and our own flesh. Baptized in order to become Christ's very own creature and live under him in his kingdom now and forever. Something else we see here in this temptation account is Christ as the new Adam. We have a lot of the same ingredients as that first temptation. A lot of similar players. We have a man. Adam's name meant man. We have a man, we have God's commands, do this, don't do that. We have eating, so Adam and Eve fell because they ate something that was forbidden. Jesus here conquers because he does not eat. He does not turn that stone into bread. He does not obey the devil as Adam and Eve obeyed the devil. He overcomes in the exact opposite ways that they fell. He is undoing their disobedience through his obedience to the Heavenly Father. He is a second Adam who is victorious over sin. And the first Adam, he was tempted in paradise. He had everything. He had it easy. He had one command, do not eat this tree. You can eat from all the other trees, but don't eat from this one. He was in paradise, things were perfect, and he fell. But where is Jesus? What's the setting for his temptation? Not paradise, but the wilderness. And the wilderness after he has been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. So where Adam fell when he had everything, Jesus surmounts and Jesus is victorious even though he has nothing and even though he is incredibly weakened. He overcomes in his temptation. And when Adam fell in his temptation, he sold himself and all of his descendants into the devil's power. But Jesus, by his triumph over the devil, by his cleaving to his heavenly Father, by his obedience to the will of God, Jesus delivers himself from that temptation and all of us, his children, by faith. It's as though he is a war champion and we are following in his train. Now that he has done battle with the devil, we too follow him marching into victory. Because Jesus did not shirk the cross. Jesus did not choose ease and food and cheap glory. Instead, he chose to go to that cross. The devil departed from him, we're told, until an opportune time. And that opportune time presented itself in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was betrayed. He said as much later on in Luke chapter 2. He said, now is the hour of the power of darkness, and that the Pharisees with their mob come to arrest Jesus, that they were now doing the devil's will. That opportune time had come for the devil to stir these people up and put Jesus on the cross. But in the very act of killing the Son of Glory, the devil sealed his own doom. Because on the cross, Jesus culminated his obedience to the Heavenly Father. You'll remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, he asked, "May this cup pass from me, dear Father, if it be your will." But it was not his will. So by going to the cross, this is one last, final and full obedience to his Heavenly Father, which undoes the disobedience of Adam and Eve and undoes all the work of the devil. Dying on the cross, Jesus shed his blood for you and for me. And now his perfect record is counted, is credited to our account. So when the devil, whose name means accuser, when the devil accuses us of sins, he has no case. He has no leg to stand on because we have been found not guilty by God our Heavenly Father. Not on account of our works, not on account of our good intentions, but on account of Jesus and his hard work, on account of his suffering, his bloody sweat, his temptation, all those things we prayed about in the litany on Ash Wednesday. He won our salvation through those things. And what's more, the book of Hebrews tells us, we have a high priest, an intercessor, an intermediary before God the Father. We have a high priest who is able to sympathize with us in our weakness. For he has been tempted as we are in every way and yet without sin. So he has been there and he has done that, yet without sin. And now he stands before the Heavenly Father as our advocate, as our intermediary, as our Lord. And he is there in heaven as the first fruits of the resurrection and life everlasting. The first fruits. He has gone on there ahead of us. We too shall rise and we too shall join him. But even now, in the valley of the shadow of death, even now, when we must go out and meet temptation, even now, when the Holy Spirit drives us back out into the wilderness of the world to follow God and do battle with sin and the devil, even now, we have Christ with us. He is with us always. He has promised never to leave us or forsake us. Our sins are forgiven, and heaven has been promised to us and God's presence with us here and now for the time being. In the name of Jesus, amen. We continue our worship with the prayers of the church. Please stand. We include a special petition today for the family and friends of Sue Hemingway. She was the wife of Pastor Bill Hemingway. Many of you heard that she died this week rather suddenly. Pastor Bill actually preached a funeral here just a month or two ago for Larry Carpenter, and she was here with us. And the Hemingways were involved, of course, in the planting of this congregation, Shepherd of the Hills. And so we remember Pastor Bill and all of Sue's family and friends who mourn this loss at that time. Each petition ends with, "Lord, in your mercy," and the congregation responds with, "Hear our prayer." Let us pray. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your goodness and bless you for the love that sustains us from day to day. We praise you for the gift of your Son, our Savior, who resisted the devil with the word of God and obeyed you and hungered and thirsted for our salvation more than he hungered and thirsted for relief from his suffering and temptation. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, for your holy Christian church, for the means of grace, for the lives of all faithful and just people, and for the hope of the life to come. Help us to treasure in our hearts all that you have done for us, and enable us to show our thankfulness in lives that are wholly given to your service. Lord, in your mercy, grant your wisdom and heavenly grace to all pastors and those who hold office in your church, that by their devoted service, faith may abound and your kingdom increase. And we pray also for all lay people, that they might hear your word to their everlasting benefit and live out lives of faith and love in the world. Lord, in your mercy, preserve our nation in justice and honor, that we may lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in our land, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of Idaho, and to all those who make, administer, or judge our laws. And we lift before you once again the situation in Ukraine. We pray, O Lord, that the best would come from it and that you would bring a speedy end to this war. Help all people everywhere to serve according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy. Sanctify our homes with your presence and bless them with joy. Keep our children in the covenant of their baptism, and enable their parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Unite the members of all families in a spirit of affection and service, that they may show your praise in our land and in all the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let your blessing remain upon the seed time and harvest, the commerce and industry, the leisure and rest, the arts and culture of our people. We pray, O Lord, especially for our economy and supply chains in light of all the stress they have undergone in the past 2 years. We pray, O Lord, that you will help us not to worry, but rather to look to you to provide for our daily bread. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
By your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. We pray especially for Pastor Bill and for all who mourn the wife of Susan. We pray likewise for Sandy, Jerry, Jan, Vaughn, Jean, Mike, Betty, Roger, Robin, Doug, Crystal, Lillian, Velma, Karis, and Cindy. We pray for the Hemingway family, the Bosino and Boyer families, and the Kendall families in their time of mourning. We lift before you all others, O Lord, who need your care in their lives, especially those we name before you in our hearts. Be with those, O Lord, who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow, and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, dear Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated as we worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Please stand as we continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. At your command, Abraham prepared to offer his son Isaac as a sacrifice on the mountain, yet in mercy you provided a ram as a substitute. We give you thanks that on Calvary you spared not your only Son, but sent him to offer his life as a ransom for many. As we eat and drink his body and blood, grant us, like Abraham our father, to trust in your promise now fulfilled in Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
And now may this true body and precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Let us pray. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who, in loving kindness, sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with hymn 718.
Oh,
You may be seated. Good morning and welcome to everyone, especially any visitors this morning. Great to see everyone here. A few announcements from me before I pass the mic along. Please note, men, that our monthly men's Bible study, I'm going to have to do a reschedule this month. It will not land on the fourth Sunday of the month. Sorry, the fourth Saturday of the month. It's going to be Saturday the 19th, so please do that. I have a personal conflict, so I'm going to need to reschedule it for the 19th. Also, please note the meeting about starting a community garden will be on Sunday, March 20th. Please come with any ideas, and it would probably be helpful if we could put together some sort of a committee or kind of leadership team on that project as well. So think about whether you might be willing to fulfill some kind of a role like that. As you heard in the prayers, Pastor Bill Hemenway's wife, Sue, died rather suddenly. The funeral will be on Friday at Christ the King at 2 p.m. This Friday, 2 p.m. at Christ the King for her funeral. I do plan to attend, but just in case any others would like to join us as well. And then next Sunday is daylight saving time, right? Or whatever, the undoing or the redoing of it, whichever one it is, 6 o'clock. Don't come to church late or early. Come right on time. Don't forget to set those things. Other announcements, Jerry.
I believe we have an elders meeting on Tuesday.
I think that's probably right. Is it the first Tuesday?
Yeah, it's second Tuesday. It is. So it's not listed in the insert. Okay. Anyway, it's not listed in the insert, but that is elders meeting. Someone was discussing that.
This is not about VBS yet. Last night I sent an email out to everybody that I have email addresses to asking if you want to opt in for text messaging. The website has the ability to do bulk text messaging. At this point, I can only do it with people that I have emails for. I'm going to talk to Concordia next week to see if we can figure out if you don't have an email, can we still get in the text messaging. So if you want to opt in to be able to get bulk text messaging sometime in the future, it's not going to cancel anything else out. It may just be another way we can reach out and get information to you quickly. Opt in through that email, and if you didn't get it, look in your spam.
It didn't make it in next week's bulletin. It was in last week's bulletin. I just wanted to remind everyone that myself and my colleague Brad Blodnick will be here next Sunday after church hosting coffee hour and donuts to answer all questions for Ivan. Make sure you're using your action teams and designating your choice dollars before the end of March, and then also to talk to you about the qualified charitable distributions.
Yeah, that's free money that we can use for all sorts of things. So that'll be helpful. It's just quiet today.
Okay. This Tuesday is Elder Roman Mill meeting again, and we would love to invite all of our ladies to that meeting, even if it fills the fellowship hall. That would be great. Please bring your brown bag lunch. It is an informational meeting as well as Bible study. Thank you very much.
Yes.
I'm going to apologize before I make the announcement. My wife put me up to it. Today's John Fowler's birthday. Sorry, John. And also, our granddaughter had her fourth birthday. Third. Fourth. Anyway.
I've done that too, yeah.
Anyway, John, happy birthday.
It's also my birthday on Thursday. And this is on Saturday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear John and Mark. Happy birthday to you.
And one more for Mark.
Just a reminder, there's cookies and coffee in the fellowship hall after church. And a big shout out to the people that brought cookies today. Thank you very much.
God's blessings to everyone on the week.